that old movie.
I think we're live.
Hey. Are we live, Corey?
We are alive, yes. Whether alive. Or not.
We are alive.
Whether or not we're live online, I have no idea.
Where's the show?
Oh, it looks like it. All right. Hey, everybody.
Hey.
There we go.
Welcome.
Share this to K-Bear South real quick.
Yeah, welcome to K-Bear South.
And we should be on YouTube. Supposed to be.
I have a couple buddies on YouTube. Buddy Joel Lackey, and Zane House.
Let me turn that. Sorry, that's kind of overbearing. All right.
Well, there we go.
Why not?
Let me turn my volume up a little bit. My voice.
Oh, we're up all the way, homie.
Oh, we are? Okay.
Yeah. You want your headphones turned up?
No, that's fine.
All right. Oh, you just want to drown me out and drown out the music.
There,
you got,
how's that?
That sounds good, though.
Okay.
Wow. Well, here we are. We said we'd be here this week, and we're here. A little late, and we're late at time. You're supposed to be here at 6, and it's 6:36, but you got to.
We're not there. We're here.
apologies. So
we're here as well.
Let us know if... in the comments of the K-Bear South group, if you have any issues hearing us or anything.
Yes.
Any complaints, but no refunds, just to let you know.
Yeah. There
we go. So it's Memorial Day 2023, and you know, people tell each other happy Memorial Day, but it's really more of a somber day. It is National Day of Remembrance, right?
Yes, it is.
So what do you say? What would you say? Is it still happy Memorial Day? I mean,
I don't say that or think that. Actually, I never really gave much thought, but until last 2 years, what this day really is. It's a remembrance of those who have given their all so we could sit here. Our Constitution, our rights. People gave their all, gave their life for that flag. They fought hard. I don't know if it's Happy Memorial Day.
I think it's happy that we have a Memorial Day. And we all get together and the nation recognizes it. And
wonder how many people are doing that. We recognize that.
I don't know. I mean, everyone I know goes and parties and has cookouts and all that stuff. And I guess that's a form of celebrating your freedom, right? That
I hope so.
Others sacrificed, you know?
Yeah.
I
hope so.
We're supposed to have a moment of silence at 3 p.m. And the flags are supposed to stay half-mast, and then I guess after 3 p.m. they raise them to show the resolve, they fought, this is for them, and then we raise it, and it's like, this is why.
I didn't know that.
Thank you. We're going to learn a lot today.
Good. I could use it.
I know, me too.
I really could.
Here in a little while, we're going to talk about your dad.
Okay. Yes, we are, yeah.
That seems very appropriate. We talked about that last time.
Yeah.
How,
there's a lot I've forgotten. I didn't, and of course I didn't have prepared anything.
Oh, it's okay. We're kind of off-the-cuff people anyway, right?
Yes, we are. That's what that, by the seat of our what? Bridges.
Sorry, I'm just still kind of browsing here and seeing... I'm really interested. Like, one thing that's messed up right now is the title. Yeah.
Is that what you're doing here?
Yeah. That tells you how long ago this was. Zooming live with Dave the Cook from K-Bear and Kylie from Australia. It's like,
this
Kylie's cool.
This is a really cool setup, Corey. I commend you on that.
It could be cooler.
It's come a lot. It's come a long ways, my friend. It really has. You navigate well.
Oh, I'm self-taught, so it's not going to be anything.
I understand that.
Actually, good
stuff, but do well.
Well, thanks, buddy.
Yeah. You do well.
So one thing I like, a lot of people didn't know, is your. Do you want to talk about your Vietnam stint?
Okay.
Or lack thereof, because it's very interesting to me.
Oh, okay. Wow.
How? For those of you guys watching, William White, Bill White Eagle, Dave the Cook,
Corey.
Any other names?
I've been called everything but a nice guy from time to time.
Everything but a nice guy?
Yeah.
People don't know what they're talking about then.
Exactly.
So.
Well, thank you everybody for stopping in, coming in, sitting in. We're just going to wing it here, more or less, and just have a chit-chat. Everybody chime in with remarks. What does it say how many people are here?
Oh, I don't know. There's different we're on different formats, so.
We'll figure it out.
It don't matter.
Yeah, okay, that's true.
Just pretend there's one, and it's Pam in the garage watching, so.
Oh, hi, Pam. Pam number one.
That's right. Pam only one.
She's a sweetheart. You folks, you got to see the love in this house. It's really, really cool. I'm really honored to be at this address. Lots of love, understanding, and respect at this address.
We're honored to have you.
Yeah,
you become family for sure. So
sure has. Yeah. Okay.
So let's go back in time.
Boy.
So the year was
1976.
1973.
But I had turned 18.
Right when you turned 18.
You had to go down to the draft card. I mean, go down and sign up for the draft. You had to. It was law.
Let's make sure people can hear you. Let me get that guy going. There you go. I'll hold it.
Okay, I'll hold it.
Okay.
Oh, wow. How's that?
Right? It sounds a little bit more clear, so.
Like this. How's
there
that?
You go.
La-da-da-da.
Then you can beatbox. I can't do it good.
I'm never good at that.
You guys
slobber all over the mic here.
Keep it going, man. You guys ever heard Dave the Cook beatbox? First time for everything. that's great. I can hear that too.
Yeah. Anyways.
Anyways.
When I 1973, when I turned 18, I was 2 years into my apprenticeship to be a machinist. I started by being in my apprenticeship when I was 16, but I had to go down to the draft service board, I think, whatever it was called, you know, and it was law. You had to go down and get your draft card. I go down and get it, and it's my number was 244. Jeez, it's been so long now, Corey.
That's good enough memory, though. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I went down and got my card. And
what was that like? I mean, you had to do it, right? And all your friends were doing it. Do you know anyone that bailed from Canada and all that?
Oh, yeah.
I know this.
Yeah. I know one guy, a couple guys, they turned gay.
Oh, and yeah, that was a strategy, wasn't it?
That was a strategy. Or be a priest. You know,
oh, really?
Yeah.
That's probably the route I would have took.
Oh, yeah. There was all kinds of stuff. And I just didn't do it. I was too busy doing my apprenticeship. I was going to go, and I talked to a recruit. When I was 16, I tried to go down just before I started my apprenticeship to be a machinist. I went down to a recruiting place. I was going to join the Navy and be a machinist that way. I get in there. I brought a note from my parents. Life at home wasn't that good back then. So I just wanted to get out of the house. My parents gave me a note. I get down there. They didn't accept me. I had braces on my teeth. They didn't want to have the accepted responsibility of finishing the orthodontics.
Oh,
my
to
teeth.
Cover your
yeah.
health care bill?
The health care bill to finish the orthodontics work.
So wow.
Yeah, true story.
It's like, hit us back up when you get your grill fixed. And if you got any other issues, take care of that first. Cause
Then when I got my draft card, because I had my that number, 244, I think it was. Anyways, had that date to go with April something. It was the last part of April. And I said, my goodbyes and everything like that. And I was in a relationship then. pretty cool, good relationship. Anyways, said my goodbyes.
What was going through your mind? Because you said you had friends that went out there. You knew people that went out there.
Yeah. And
did
didn't
you know
come
anyone
back.
That had died at that point?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and the guys didn't come back. Guys that came back were all screwed up in the head.
Yeah, PTSD, yeah. If they weren't missing limbs or whatever. Uh-huh. Yeah, I imagine.
And really screwed up bad. And a couple of them got in prison. But it was it's a sad story.
Of course.
Even got a couple family members. It was sad to see. Yeah. I didn't really think of it either way. I accepted it. I'm going. That's just the way I look at it.
You're just going with the flow, huh?
Going with the flow.
Doing what you're, what they required of you.
What they required. No, I didn't think of it. I really didn't yet think of it one way or another. I really didn't.
Wow.
Yeah. Accepted it. And anyways, long story short, 3 days before I was supposed to go, they abolished the draft within 72 hours.
Wow.
True story.
It was all done.
It was all done. And they abolished the draft.
Was that the... So was the war ended?
No,
They just got rid of the draft.
Got rid of the draft. And I didn't really pay too much attention to the news. I really haven't, even to today. I think the war went on back until 1975.
Yeah, gotcha.
They had to, evacuate everybody.
They just, that was the wind down, I guess. They weren't bringing more people in at that point, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. Not drafted anymore.
Wow.
Yeah. And, I didn't have to go.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And I forgot where I'm at right now. So,
you're just talking.
Yeah.
So what happened after that? When did you celebrate? Like,
we did celebrate.
Let's go get some mushrooms and a quart of whiskey or something.
I didn't really drink much back then, but I did a lot of psychedelics.
Yeah, I bet.
Yeah, it was psychedelics and cannabidiol.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
That was a pretty cool thing back then. We did party like quite a bit with that. Yeah.
So, I bet your family was happy, right? Your parents and everything?
Dad, he didn't really have much to say about it.
He was kind of indifferent?
Yeah, just okay, go back to work.
Wow.
Yeah.
Just nonchalant. Did he give you, since he had been in World War II, fighting Nazis and whatnot, did he give you any kind of advice? Or
no.
Did he talk to you about the...
No, he didn't.
Wow.
Through then, I moved out and then didn't really check in very often.
Yeah, I hear you.
Being young and dumb and,
right.
A rebel, the way I left home.
Yeah.
And all the stuff in between there. But wasn't until Dad was older and told me, I'd like to record you. So I do it somewhere out in one of those boxes. I get 4 or 5 cassettes. I had one of the TX 4 tracks.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and have him on tape talking about his induction and what he did during the Second World War. And I really didn't know anything about that. I didn't know he had 9 medals until after he passed away.
Wow, he just didn't talk about it in general.
He didn't talk about it. That's what those men did back then.
Right.
All those old boys, they just didn't talk about it. What I do have on tape, he was, he didn't get sad or indifferent, or he just said what happened. And he saw a lot of death.
Yeah.
Dad, he was a soldier doing his job, and he saw a lot of death. He saw a lot of shit. His whole life, when he was a child, he was estranged from his family. He ended up in reform schools, and then back then the Indian schools. Mom too, and what the Catholics did the beach stuff.
Yeah.
All
yeah.
that. What you saw in
1883, right?
1883. What you saw then is a true story. My parents lived through that. Dad in Vermont, my mom in northern Vancouver Island, as far west as you can get. Yeah.
Now, so were they religious? Your parents religious or?
No. Well, mom was more religious.
Okay.
Catholic, but mostly a Christian, a forced Catholic.
Right.
And when we were young kids, a Christian. Mm. And she didn't push it or anything. Just that was her belief and stuff. And Native American tradition. Yeah.
Oh, very cool.
My dad he sat down and I recorded Dad. Jesus. A couple weeks.
Two weeks of recording and whatnot?
About that long.
And you still have those tapes?
Yes, the tapes are out in the garage. I saw one of them.
We gotta go rip them.
And we'll get them.
Digitize.
We'll have to get
send it to the Smithsonian. You never know.
Exactly. Yeah, there's a lot there, Corey.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, because tape degrades over time, especially in this Texas heat. So you should get on the ball.
Yeah, we'll have to get one of those four-track recorders, a TX four-track.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's on the cassette four-track.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what I recorded them on.
Right on.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
Oh, yeah. But my goodness, what that man saw, what he did, the battles he was in, and he was a forward observer, a sniper.
Oh, yeah?
And him being a forward observer, that's the guy that gets out there and reports what he sees and stuff like that, and guides artillery in.
And oh, okay, kind of like a reconnaissance.
Exactly, forward observer.
Got forward observer.
Yeah.
Okay, I never heard that term before.
Yeah, that's what he said he was. And we'll see in his medals there, he's got a whole chest full of medals for being a marksman.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and pull that up.
Yeah. He, my goodness.
For being a marksman, huh?
He was a marksman, dude. Yeah. And from across the field, he remember one time he said he saw this high-ranking Nazi.
There you go.
There they are.
There's your dad's medals.
That one in the middle there, right there.
Yeah, the cross.
Yeah, that one. That's a marksman.
Oh, okay.
Each one of those there's.
I mean, these are Nazi medals too. Like.
Yes. Yeah. Those are what he took. And those three shells right there.
Oh, to the right?
Yeah, to the right there.
Corner?
In the
yeah.
corner. Those were had his funeral. He had 21 guns.
Oh, that's right.
21 gun salute.
That's right.
Yeah. Bronze star. This one right here, the bottom one for being in battle. The one below that arrow, your mouse there.
Oh.
That right there, yeah.
Oh, this one?
Yeah, that
at
one
the
there.
Very bottom, not even in the box.
Yeah, it's not. That's on a beret.
On a beret, okay.
Yeah.
So at the very bottom of the screen, you guys.
Yeah, that's a that's on a beret.
Who has these now?
My grandson.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah, I gave them to my daughter to hold, but and my grandson has them now.
Good. And how old is he now?
About 21, 22.
Okay, so he's old enough to give it the proper respect and care that it needs, right?
I'm sure he does.
Awesome.
Yeah, he's got a good head on his shoulders. Yeah.
Well, that's very cool, man. It's kind of it's good to keep it going as an heirloom, you know?
Exactly.
These medals don't come easy. So.
Yeah, I when I sent for them and got them, I didn't realize there was 9 of them there that he got. He never said a word about them.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
So, since we're on the topic of your dad and his service, let's go ahead and show everyone the picture of him and kind of, you know, break it down for us.
Okay. Well, I'm starting to get clogged up at all.
There
that's,
we go.
That's a good job bringing that back, Corey.
Oh yeah.
That's the sky, those buildings behind there, and that fence.
Yeah.
That's a challenge. That sky is really washed out. That was taken in 1945. Has a caption on the back, just after a big battle. So I don't know which one that was. He was 45, 23 years old right there.
How old was he?
23.
Wow.
And not everybody, you had to qualify to shoot that Thompson or that machine gun.
Uh-huh.
You had to qualify to be able to hold one of those things.
Yeah, so there's the original photo.
Yeah.
I know some folks, they want to see the original. You know? So he gives it character, all that.
Yeah.
When
I brought these photos to the VA in Seattle, the main office.
Uh-huh.
They wanted to put them in the museum.
They did, huh?
Yeah, because the whole stack of them, there was a, that should be out there somewhere, Corey. There's a concentration camp that they found.
Oh, wow.
Uh-huh. And it's gruesome. A couple pictures of that.
Yeah, dude.
Mm-hmm.
Should compile the stuff and...
Have to fight
them. If you still have them and they're decent quality, you know.
Yeah.
These are... Scan them in, touch them up, and then put the audio... Mm-hmm. To like a slideshow from your dad's tapes, you know.
That photograph that you scanned in there.
Yeah.
That's an original photograph that he took.
Let's get to that then. I'll get that brought up here.
Go
ahead. Yeah, keep talking.
And these pictures here, Corey. Yeah. These pictures were developed on scrap paper and somewhere in France. And it lost the negatives in France somewhere.
Really?
Uh-huh. That picture, that's Burgess Garden.
And, yeah, you still have that one, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, that's the one you did
right,
today.
I scanned in.
That's the one he took. That's the... That's literally been through a war.
Right, right. And let me see if you guys can see this or not. But this is the actual original photo.
Yep. You can Google it.
And it's just...
Google Burgess Garden. Hitler's castle. And you'll see the exact same picture. And that's when the... in April 1945, after Hitler committed suicide... the Russians took Berlin, and they gave Burgess Garden, Hitler's castle, to the 101st. Could you imagine what those men felt like?
Yeah.
You know, when you young boys, when they play war, stuff like that.
Right.
What the object is, to get the other guy's flag.
I mean,
capture the flag. Yeah. Can you imagine what those guys felt like?
I cannot.
You know?
I cannot imagine.
After they'd been through, Daddy was in through North Africa. Jason Rommel. I forgot the campaign, the theaters. I forgot the names of all those down.
That's no less than amazing, man.
And then, Market Garden. And he has three combat jumps. Jumped out of a perfectly good airplane into combat. And instead of shooting his gun, shooting that machine gun, he's taking pictures. I have those pictures.
That's amazing. Yeah, and your dad took this photo.
He took this right photo right here. Yeah, Hitler's castle. There's other ones.
Didn't you have a name for it? It's
Burgess Garden.
Burgess Garden, that's right. And it's dated on the back.
Yeah, April of 45.
44.
Oh, 44?
Yeah. April of 44.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing, though?
Isn't that?
It's just a tiny little photo.
Yeah, developed on scrap paper somewhere in France.
I know. Hey,
that photo you're holding.
I know. I'm almost afraid to touch it.
1945. That's how old that picture is right there.
From 44.
World, 44, yeah.
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 I mean, I just can't imagine traveling all that way with that precious little.
Yeah. Other photographs. They're different right. size, too, with the, whatever that, the person who developed it. He only had so much paper to put it on, develop it on.
I hope they're still back there.
I hope so, too.
When we get done here, we should go in there and look through and see if we can find them, because in the summertime, it gets a little hot, you know?
Yeah.
I don't want them to succumb to any elements here in Texas, you know?
Yeah, it's here looking at it, Corey. I'm getting choked up.
This is an amazing life, dude. It's your dad.
Again, he saw a lot of death. Stories he has. There was a night out there doing it, out there by himself, and he sees this log. And walks up this log, fallen log. But it's kind of one end of it's up in the air. So he wanted to see what's out there. So he walks up this tree, up on this log, gets out there. There's a German right below him. And then they see each other, nod their heads, just go different ways. So that happened a few times. It's not worth it.
Wow. Yeah. I can only imagine. Now, you're the seventh son of a seventh son, right?
My dad was 7th to 13.
Wow.
I'm 7th to 9. There's a there's some females in there, my sisters, older than me. But there is a seventh son of a seventh son. There's dad has had an interesting life, and as well as I have. Had some
absolutely
odd and Yeah, there's been some interesting things going on in my life.
Yeah, and, you know, your approach to life, I learned after living with you these years, like, how you took being drafted from Vietnam, just going with the flow.
Yeah.
You know, you didn't really panic or fret, like.
I didn't.
I don't think people realize that's you, like, every day. Oh. You know what I mean? It's crazy.
Yeah.
I just don't know. I can get stressed out and, you know. I'll curse the world and everything else, and you know, you got it as far as like being in pain and all that stuff. It's like, and you don't even raise an eyebrow. You know, you take it in stride, and you taught me how to do that for the most part.
Yeah. That there, it's
I want to get to your level. I really do. So
I didn't know or realize I was on a level there. I'm still learning. And I'm still learning that inside stuff. But the committee's pretty busy upstairs.
Yeah. Did you have any other family members get called out to war?
No.
Just your dad and you.
Just my dad. My older brother's they're Canadian.
Oh, okay.
And then I'm
they don't. Fights, do they?
Yeah, they did. The Canadians. They didn't have
They do. I don't want no Canadians getting pissed at me or anything. Yeah. I know they do.
They do. I'm sure I'll have some my nephews and nieces are in our group here, Corey. So
good.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, they'll be chiming in sometime. There's a whole bunch of really my cousins.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I've invited them to the group.
Oh nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Welcome then.
Oh yeah. They'll be chiming in here in a little bit, probably.
Nice to informally meet you.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Oh, we got 479 subscribers.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's just, that's neither here nor there.
Yeah.
I don't really push subscribe. You watch all the videos on here, and you won't see me be like, don't forget to like and subscribe.
Yeah.
Don't forget to follow. Don't forget to share. I don't do that stuff. Yeah. So that's all as organic as it gets, you know.
Yeah. We're both
there's
the
479
same.
People out of all the years I've been doing videos that appreciate the stuff enough to subscribe to it. And you know what? I'm tickled as hell about that.
There you go.
Those are my people.
We're both the same there, Corey.
I don't need thousands. I just need that 479.
There you go.
They're the cool guys. They get it.
Much obliged with that. Yeah. Yeah, we're both the same there.
Oh, man.
Yeah, Dad. I'm trying to think of a couple of stories that Dad went through. And I'm drawing a blank here.
Oh, well, we just...
He was a... I don't remember what town he was. He was called in. These high-ranking Germans that were barricaded in this basement building. So they called their dad in to shoot a bazooka.
Oh, damn.
Yeah, he was a marksman for that, for one of those. That's part of those one medals I was showing you there.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyways, they called him in, and he had a across the street and back maybe 20, 30 yards and shoot into this doorway to get these German guys in there. I don't want to screw this up. Anyways, he takes one shot and it missed it a couple yards, right? And he goes, okay, he looked at it and got it down on one knee.
Yeah.
He skipped the bazooka shell.
What do you mean, like a rock across the river?
Yes, yeah, he skipped it off the street and bounced it off the street.
Oh, my God.
And it went through the door.
Wow.
Yeah. You got 27 Germans, though, in one day.
Jeez, really?
Yeah.
A force to be reckoned with, huh?
Oh, he was, his sergeant got shot and pinned down. And it almost killed him. It's interesting now. When I was a kid, he would, I forgot his name. He would call him up somewhere in Alabama. He kept in touch with him for quite some time. It pissed him off. He got 27 of them in one day.
Wow.
He got 9 medals there.
I'm sure he got one of the medals for that, too.
Yeah, I think that was one of them, huh? I think that the Bronze Star was for Battle of the Bulge.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, I think that was. Who was that? That 5-star general, Patton.
Patton, yeah.
Yeah, he was pretty impressed with everybody.
We're surrounded.
Yeah, he told this one guy commenting on this one guy for valor. You know, give him a Bronze Star. He goes, oh hell, give them all a Bronze Star. I'm pretty sure that was it. We're surrounded.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember his quote. A pint of sweat will save a gallon of blood.
Wow.
That's not the one I was looking at, but... Oh, I just can't remember.
Yeah.
I think it was like, we're surrounded, and he was like, good, there's no place else for them to go.
Yeah.
Something like that. Anyway, I'm not, you know, you don't want to get stories wrong, and I'm misquoting everything, I'm sure, so.
Yeah, I'm drawing a big blank here, Corey. I didn't sleep very good last night, for one thing.
Oh, that's no good. Now, as far as your dad, how did he end up passing? Because, was it diabetes he had?
No, actually, he didn't have any,
Because you said something that changed him.
And he had just a stroke.
Oh, stroke, yes.
He had a stroke back in 71. Yeah, just before I left home, he had gotten a stroke. And he just got changed. He didn't have that fight to get back.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
That's tough.
He does, yeah.
Dad had a stroke, too, and that's, you know, some of them are bad, and you can't come back from them, you know.
Yeah.
And it, you know, and the depression moved. And
worry, my goodness, he worried and worried hard. That's I saw that, Corey. That's why I don't worry today.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw that, and I'm not going to do that. And to this day, I've had my moments. You know, we all do.
Yeah.
But I don't do that or fret over it or, you know, worry that hard. Mm. You know, I've had my moments. But
good advice. Have,
yeah. It's good not good for it's not good for the body, the soul, the spirit. Again, I've had my minutes. Is that everybody chiming in there?
Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah. We got JP in the chat on YouTube. Gigi Sovereign.
Okay.
From Australia, I think.
Oh, right on.
So that's cool. They're digging your stories, buddy.
Yeah, we know a couple people down in Australia. Mary, she's from Australia.
Yeah.
And got that buddy Joe, guy with the diving school with. He's part of the group.
Awesome.
Remember that story he had? He was not doing good, and he saw Dave the cook somehow.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I forgot how that goes. We'll get a hold of one day. Yeah, it's an interesting story. God, I'm drawing a big blank, Corey.
Oh, it's all right. Move on talking. Let's talk about Moultrie Patton.
Oh, another jeez. He was a tank man. He was that
veteran, yeah.
He was a Battle of the Bulge. And he was a tank commander.
So him and your dad were there.
Yeah, they didn't know each other.
Right. Wouldn't that be crazy if one of his tanks or your dad was jumping out of a plane over one of his tanks, you know, down there? You know, wouldn't that be crazy?
Wouldn't that? No, they'd never met. But Moultrie, oh my goodness. Walt. Yeah. I would call him by his stage name. He would call, oh, jeez. We'd spend hours on the phone just talking.
Yeah, and you'd call him Walt?
Yeah, I'd call him.
He'd call you Dave.
He'd call me Dave.
See, I don't want people to get mad at me, like, you know, because I call you Dave.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's just a fun context, and you get it.
Yeah, I'd get it.
But, you know, some people, oh, that's Bill.
Yeah, that has happened.
That's William. Call him by his name.
Yeah.
Like, no, Dave's his name, buddy.
Yeah, that's right.
And he's going to cook some salmon, bro.
Yeah. Yeah, we call each other by stage name. And
that is so cool.
And I didn't realize that Moose Fest. Of course, everybody caught it right away.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I bet that just made everyone's day.
Oh, it sure did.
I mean, what it does, it puts people there, especially at Moose Fest. Like, I never got to go when Walt was there.
Uh-huh.
You know, I missed them early years, but I, you know, that would have just made my day. Especially if everyone else got into it. Like, yeah. Hey, Joel, you know, if Rob Morrow showed up.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Joel. Hey, Dave. Hey, Walt.
Yeah. We got drunk right in front of everybody.
Did you?
Oh, me, Walt. And Walt.
Hey, and keep it going, man. It's all good.
And Barry.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we got Maurice. Hammered. Yeah. It was a lot of fun.
Actually, you don't want to call Elaine Marilyn, I hear.
No.
I hear she gets really...
Yeah. I've never seen it.
I don't either.
Mm-hmm.
That's just what I hear.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to test it. So.
Exactly. Don't need to go there.
That's right.
That's right. Look, guy, you're doing really good there. No drop frames.
Ah, yeah. Well,
good job, Corey.
Got to pay the cost for that internet speed, you know?
38 minutes we've been on.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we'll start winding it down. Let everyone go about their business. Just want to talk about Walt a little bit.
Yeah.
Moultrie Patton.
Moultrie, gosh. He was going to be for this production I was doing.
Oh, that's right. On the Lamb?
Is on the Lamb.
Yeah.
We'll put that stuff up one day. We'll talk about
that. Yeah, we'll talk about it.
Yeah. But sure. Walt. he was going to need to do the voiceover. His voice is really unique. And I had all his stuff written, and he loved it. Loved it. Oh, goodness. But we never had a chance to get together. We talked on the phone. He read the stuff, and really loved the writing, the direction it was going. And he really loved the project. Because I loved his voice.
Yeah, it was a very unique voice.
Uh-huh. So I wrote all this stuff just for him. You know, he did a good job with it.
Very cool.
you talk on the phone, and he'd be playing his piano while we're talking and stuff. Just having a good old time. He's a jazz pianist.
That's right.
Uh-huh. Very, very good.
That's right. One of these days, we'll pop his CD in and listen to it.
Okay.
Get everyone else to hang out with us.
Yeah, he was at the Battle of the Bulge.
Yeah. Yeah, it says here.
He missed about.
He was drafted as well.
Yes, he was.
Into the military during World War II.
Oh, is that
he served as a tank commander.
Hey, you got it right there. All right on.
During the Battle of Monte Cassino. Was that a? That sounds Italian.
It does.
Monte Cassino, for which he received a Silver Star for heroism, and guess what? 1944.
He didn't.
Same year that picture was taken.
Mm-hmm. He didn't. He didn't talk about that Silver Star or anything, because those boys didn't.
Huh.
He just said he's a tank commander, and saw some heavy stuff, but he missed some of. He had to go back and get gas. He's running low on gas.
Oh no.
Yeah, so he had to go get fuel. So I missed a good portion of the battle, of which, you know, probably saved his life, him and his crew.
Yeah, it even says right there on his tombstone, Silver Star.
Oh, right on. Good
March 18, 2009,
oh,
passed away from pneumonia.
Yeah. We had some good conversations, Corey.
I bet. I wish I could have been a fly on that wall.
We did.
Actually, I wish I could have been old enough to be hanging out with you guys. That would have been better than a fly on the wall.
Oh,
but still.
You would have fit right in. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah, he really loved the project. Liked the writing.
On the Lamb? Yeah.
On the Lamb. Mm-hmm.
Definitely talked. We got some video of that, too, from back in the day.
Yeah.
The huge production. People probably, you know, don't realize. If they don't know about it, they don't realize all the work you put into that. You put your heart and soul into that.
Boy,
and then
yeah.
The recession hit and production stopped.
Yeah.
On a lot of new things.
Boy, I had this investor from China.
That's right. Uh-huh. That's right.
Mr. Poon. He's ready to do it. All of a sudden, the recession hit. 2008, something like that?
Yep.
Yeah. Anyways, yeah. That was a lot of fun. I took that as far as I could. Those are real numbers that on those brochures and everything.
Uh-huh.
Those were real numbers. About.
I know, that was pretty neat.
Yeah.
And everything, you let me look through it. As for Ruth Ann, Peg Phillips,
Peggy.
She never served. No. But didn't you say she was in?
She was her husband at the time. She was in Pearl Harbor. She was there. She's a survivor, everybody.
She was there when it got bombed.
When it got bombed. She was. She had bombs were going off in her front yard.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. She wrote about that. And her daughter, oh, God, I spaced her name out. At Moose Fest. At Snow Fest.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. There's a whole bunch of us there. Anyways, I forgot her name. My gosh. She read it. I think Maria. She's a part of the group, isn't she? Anyways, yeah.
I'm not sure. I think we have a few Marias.
Yeah. Peg, I miss her, too. We talked a lot on the phone as well.
Elizabeth?
No.
If I said her name, would you be able to? Would you know? Okay.
It'll come up.
Yeah.
Or somebody will chime in with it.
Yeah, if you know in the comments, let us know.
Yeah.
Kathy?
No.
Virginia?
No.
Arthur?
Uh-uh.
And not Elizabeth?
No, it's not.
Well, that's every four, that's all four of her kids, dude. So.
My mind is goes.
It's okay.
Yeah.
Hey, I can be wrong too. I don't know.
Yeah, she did a lot for the youth, for the children.
Uh huh.
Yeah, I was gonna help her with some of that stuff, but some of the transportation and stuff just didn't work out.
Oh, Didn't you say she had a knack for always finding you?
Oh, gosh, Corey. Yes, she did.
Like, it didn't matter where you were?
No matter where I was at. I'd be playing hooky down in Centralia, and she would find that phone number. Yeah, it was amazing. And then she would show up at looping sessions. I'd look up, and there she is, sitting there with a big smile behind the glass. Wow. She made me feel good.
That is cool.
Yeah. It was sure heartfelt.
So when it comes to Memorial Day, you don't have to. I mean, there's a whole other group of species you need to really consider when you're giving thanks on Memorial Day to those that have fallen.
Oh, yes, we do. We all should
because
be.
Because they're service dogs that have earned medals, right?
Exactly. We should be
so
grateful for those.
I wanted to just name a few of those, if that's okay.
Sure.
All right, so we got Sergeant Stubby here. Oh, he was actually promoted to Sarge, okay? That's how cool this guy was. I don't know if cats, you know, that's why I'm a dog person. I'm not so much of a cat person. I don't think cats pull military service anytime.
Those pictures you pulled up earlier?
Uh-huh.
We got some cool pictures, folks. Where'd you get them from? Oh,
the internet.
That's Stubby?
I don't have these in my wallet.
Yeah.
I like dogs, but I don't have an old picture of Sergeant Stubby in my wallet, that's for sure.
That's pretty cool, so, Corey, you did that.
He started as a normal civilian canine living near Yale University in 1917. While members of the 102nd Infantry trained on university grounds, Corporal James Robert Conroy became particularly fond of this Boston Terrier mix. And when the unit shipped out for France, Conroy hid Stubby under his overcoat. Conroy's commanding officer eventually discovered Stubby. Fortunately, Stubby saluted the commanding officer
wagged his tail
upon detection and was allowed to stay as the official mascot of the 102nd Infantry Regiment.
Right on.
In total, Stubby participated in 4 offenses and 17 battles on the Western Front.
Jeez.
Over the course of 18 months.
Really?
Stubby overcame multiple injuries to help protect his allies from enemies, locating missing soldiers and alert fellow troops to duck for cover when he heard the whine of incoming artillery shells. Can you imagine?
And finding the fallen.
Right, right. And he also wore a specially designed gas mask to protect him from mustard gas.
Hmm.
Some soldiers even claim that Stubby captured a German soldier by refusing to let go of his pants until fellow soldiers found him. Understandably, Stubby was a celebrity after the war. The charismatic canine met multiple presidents and led several parades across the country.
Right on.
He was also presented with a gold medal from the Humane Education Society, and even became the team mascot for the Georgetown Hoyas football team.
Good.
Thank you for your service, Sergeant Stubby.
Good job.
Good boy. I hope he got lots of treats. He deserves it.
Yes, he does. That's World War One.
Oh, and mustard gas.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, 1917.
Jeez.
Smart dog. I mean, I guess it just fell into the role, right? Like
exactly.
All right.
My dad's father, he was in the First World War, and my great-great-grandfather was in the Civil War.
Wow.
I could trace that lineage back to through that. He was at the burning of Atlanta.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh. I forgot his name now. And back then, if you didn't want to go to war, or if you could pay somebody $200 and you didn't have to go.
Oh.
Yeah.
Pay to not play, huh?
Exactly.
Anyway, that's kind of how it is now. It's just not that. It's not discreet. Like,
exactly.
It's like, hey, you know, oh, you got the money? Okay, you don't have to go. Mm-hmm.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah. Why do they always send the poor, right? That's what they say.
Mm-hmm.
So we got Smokey. Want to hear another one?
Sure.
This one's a Yorkshire Terrier. Okay, just a little guy. There he is.
Well, that's yeah. That's the first one. Look at the stripes are bigger than he is.
Isn't that something? They don't have to be big and strong to be heroes, though.
Oh, that's right.
When an American soldier found Smokey in an abandoned foxhole in the New Guinea jungle,
New Guinea.
She was already a fully grown terrier and weighed all of 4 pounds.
That New Guinea, that South Pacific stuff, that was some wicked, wicked stuff.
Smokey then traveled with Corporal William A. Wynn's backpack for the next 2 years of World War II. During that time, the duo served in the South Pacific with the 5th Air Force and flew a dozen air, sea rescue, and photo reconnaissance missions.
Mm.
In her military service, Smokey managed to survive 150 air raids on New Guinea and endured a typhoon in Okinawa.
Wow.
One of Smokey's greatest accomplishments was made possible by her diminutive size. When military engineers needed to build a critical air base for Allied warplanes, the team needed to run telegraph wire through a 70-foot-long pipe that was only 8 inches in diameter. Soil had filled most of the pipe, which meant the engineers would be exposed to a 3-day dig, exposed to bombings, except that Smokey was able to fit in the partially filled pipe and finish the task in minutes.
Imagine that.
I know, right? Also, holds the honor of being the first recorded therapy dog. Smokey's healing efforts began at the 233rd Station Hospital in New Guinea when she would visit injured soldiers coming from Biak Island invasion. Yeah. Her work as a therapy dog continued for more than a decade, long after she and Wynn left New Guinea for Wynn's hometown of Cleveland.
They called it shell shock back then.
Right.
Uh huh.
Man, and you see pictures of that stuff,
yep.
And you can just see the guy's eyes, like they're gone.
Yeah,
like,
that thousand-yard stare, they called it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That was pretty cool, Corey.
I thought so, right?
Nice you did that.
I don't think my dog would be that heroic if she went out to war. Oh. But, I mean, you never know until you're put there, right?
Exactly.
You never know.
She would.
She'd run up to the enemy soldiers and
lick them to death.
Yeah. Yeah. Put her hands on her knee like, give me some pets.
Yeah. She's got me trained.
Same here.
She knows her job well. Sansa. I almost forgot her name. What else you got there, Corey?
I got one more if you want to hear it.
Sure.
Do you guys want to hear it? Just
clap your hands.
I'm not reading the chat, so I hope you do. I'll just assume you say yeah. You said yes, so.
Don't say no and don't say maybe. Just say yeah.
Just say yeah. It's so good to say yes. So anyway, this one's Luca. A veteran of more than 400 bomb detection missions, okay?
Jeez.
This one's a little bit more recent.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah. I'm a German Shepherd fan, too. It's
look at that. Look at her look.
One of the first dogs I ever had was a German Shepherd.
Right on. Oh, you got a missing paw.
Right, right. It's from service.
Jeez.
So while some military dogs wind up in combat, others are trained as specialized search dogs. Of these many heroic canines, Luca is one of the most notable bomb detection dogs in history. A German Shepherd, a Belgian Malinois mix, was deployed twice to Iraq and once to Afghanistan. She served more than 400 missions during her tenure, finding ammunition, explosives, and insurgents at least 40 times during her six-year career.
6 years.
6 years, that's right. More notably, there wasn't a single human fatality under her watch despite the dangerous conditions.
Hmm.
A lifesaver, man.
Yep.
Luca went out on her final mission in 2012 when she uncovered a 30-pound explosive device. While continuing her search, another device detonated underneath her.
Oh.
Luca's handler ran to her rescue despite known active explosives in the area.
Hmm.
Luca lost her front left leg, but was able to recover from her injury and walk again in 10 days.
10 days.
After her sacrifice, Luca retired and moved back home with Gunnery Sergeant Chris Willingham. Like Gander, Luca was awarded the Nicken Medal, earning hers in 2016. Thank you for your service,
Luca. Right on.
Saved a lot of lives, man. Can you imagine?
The Nicken Medal? Never heard that.
Yeah.
She was in, geez. Look at that expression on her.
Right?
That's humble.
It kind of reminds me of, you know, they say all dogs go to heaven and whatnot.
Yeah.
Maybe some people, I mean, some dogs have such human
traits.
Yeah. Yes. And it just reminds me of Rick the dog, you know, whenever he came back reincarnated. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, there's like parallels there.
There is.
And that goes in with the extraordinary writing of the show.
It really does, doesn't it?
I mean, is there anything you could think of out there that the show did not touch on in some way or another? Wow. Like reincarnated dogs, like boom, there it is. Mm-hmm. From a guy that got hit by a satellite. If someone told me that and I didn't know anything about Northern Exposure, I'd have to watch that episode at least, right?
Yeah. Yeah, they're filmed. That was the first season. They're filming that outside that church. It was raining and pretty cold that day.
Yeah, so tell me about this. We're going to play a video now real quick, and then we'll get out of y'all's hair.
Mm-hmm. This song?
And we're going to try to, yeah. We'll try to come back, you know, at least once a week. You know, we want to hang out with you guys and stuff. So
I'll be
sorry we were late this time.
I'll be a little more prepared too, everybody. Excuse me.
Yeah, me too.
Interesting story behind this song. One moment, please.
Yeah. Get some lubrication on.
Lo.
Me.
Me.
Farther.
Hold this, please.
Sure. Got two turntables and a microphone. Shia. Uber driver smells.
Thank you, sir. This song, I call it A Wretch Like Me. Take it from the words of that song, Amazing Grace. There's this one song that just, come on, Bill, get it together.
It's okay.
I took two songs and mixed them together. Parts of it I had to speed up, slow down. Took about a long time to do this song, but I wanted to do it for my dad. This Native American drumming band. I'm drawing big blanks today, Corey.
It's okay. You're on the spot, is why.
Oh.
When you go live, you tend to go blank every once in a while. More often, anyway.
Yeah.
So.
I'd hardly any sleep, and I could justify all that stuff, all the hell.
Right. So this Native American drum.
Yeah, drumming group? Song.
It's called tribe.
They're from Yakima.
Okay.
Uh huh.
Up there, where you're from, huh?
That's my sister's husband.
Oh, okay.
Randy.
And you're Iroquois, right?
I'm Iroquois and New Charles.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, they're from Yakima. Black. Anyways, they have a song called Soldier Boy. You'll hear it in the song. They're talking about World War One, World War Two, Vietnam, Korea. It's all in the song. Then I wanted to take Amazing Grace, excuse me, the bagpipes. I took these two songs and mixed them together, and we'll play it here in a few moments. But I got them done, and I played it for these guys, Corey.
Uh-huh.
They were blown away.
Oh, they dug it, huh?
They really dug it.
It is pretty cool.
Yeah. Let's play her.
Okay. You got it.
Turn it up real loud, everybody. Oh, this is on YouTube.
Oh, yeah. Well, we'll get to that when we come back.
Crank it up.
Oh! Discovered and explored. The potential to be free inside yourself is waiting like a cocoon about to release its beauty from within. There are no limitations in what you can do, except the limitations held deep within a pit where we don't care to talk about. Hold your heart and say a silent prayer, and may the spirit of peace walk within you.
Very cool.
I forgot about that ending there. Been a long time since we heard it.
That is awesome.
Thank you, Corey.
Very appropriate for Memorial Day, I think so.
It is. I put these songs together. I was going to write a script, make a movie for my dad. This is going to be for the opening credits, just playing this here, playing this song. And
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Very nice. And I like your ending there. Where you spoke in, you
yeah, know, that
oratory, poem? I guess.
Mm-hmm. Dad wrote that geez, a long, long time ago.
I was going to ask, yeah, how long ago was that made?
Ooh. 90s, late 90s.
And what year did your dad pass away?
I think about 2004.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah. So he heard it. What did he think?
He was pretty impressed with it.
Very cool.
Yeah.
I got another poem here. You want to read?
Sure.
You have such a good voice, and I've told people, you know, that, you know, because we both make music, and I do the lo-fi stuff, you know, yeah. and the chill music to relax to and whatever. And I always thought it'd be cool because you write a lot, and I've hit you up, you know, before, and we just haven't done it yet, but
yeah.
How cool it'd be to hear some of your poems and
there's a lot
and writings over some tunes.
Yeah, like that one there?
Yeah, like that one there. It was great. Mm-hmm. So let me find it here real quick.
My hard reading's pretty bad.
Well, let us be the judge of that. We're going to put you up on a soapbox. There's a little pedestal here. We'll see.
Hey.
We're going to judge you.
Okay, here we go. And yet I was put in front of a camera.
And the right? Oh, well, let me, speaking of camera, sorry, y'all.
It's, oh.
Hey, we're back.
Hello, everyone. Ooh, and oh, wow. All
right, so the reason, you know, going back to Memorial Day is, I guess red poppies symbolize remembrance, okay?
Okay.
And that was inspired by this poem, In Flanders Fields, and it was by Lieutenant Colonel John McCrae.
Okay.
Red poppies have become a symbol of remembrance for fallen soldiers. The tradition was popularized by Moyna Michael, who campaigned to make the red poppy a symbol of remembrance.
Good.
Of remembrance. Sorry, I'm doing the same thing. You're rubbing off on me. I'm rubbing off on me.
I think you would do a better job right now. That's the reading this, Corey.
Oh, you want me to do it?
Please.
Okay, you got it.
Yeah.
After we built it up and put you on the spot, I told you we're going to judge you and everything.
Oh, goodness. I'm being choked up here.
Oh, it's okay, buddy. Don't worry about it. In Flanders fields, the poppies blow. Between the crosses, row on row, that mark our place and in the sky, the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead, short days ago. We lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow. Loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw. The torch be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
Very good. I like that a lot.
It's a good poem, isn't it?
Yeah, I'd like to get a copy of that. We'll include that somewhere.
Well, I'll have to get my, what is that? Papyrus paper and my calligraphy pen.
Okay.
And, you know, if you want a copy of it, you got to do it with some style, right? Okay. Like,
Yes, indubitably.
Yeah, so very cool.
It's too bad we couldn't play that door song.
Did someone say door song?
Yeah.
All right. Well, we're about to get out of here anyway. Maybe I'll throw it on at the end.
Okay.
See if we don't get taken down for it. That's why I didn't open with it. But, you know, Unknown Soldier, right?
Unknown Soldier by the Doors?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's very, very apropos.
That's right. Right. It's a good Memorial Day song because, you know, we actually have the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier here.
Yes.
And I don't know if other countries, I haven't researched it or heard anything, but, you know, we actually have a tomb dedicated to unknown soldiers that perished and
mm-hmm.
gave everything.
I don't think any other country or any other place on the planet does that.
I would hope they would, but I'm going to have to look into it.
Does anybody know?
I'm interested. Yeah, if you guys know, comment.
Yeah, chime in and let us know.
Save me some time. But it seems like every country should, you know.
Exactly.
Because, I mean, the unknown soldier.
Very important.
And I tell you, though, I can imagine other countries going the distance that our country goes through to
recognize.
To commemorate and protect, you know, because we have guards, the guards that patrol back and forth
mm-hmm.
24 hours a day, seven days a week, 365 days a year.
Mm-hmm.
And if you guys get on YouTube, it's kind of funny because if you go on YouTube and you'll see people just really being dumb, like, and disrespectful, because you're not supposed to cross the chains. And
yeah.
People want to get a closer picture of it or a better look, and them guys, they belt it out. Do not get behind, you know.
Yeah.
Do not cross the chains and rails.
Yeah.
You know. And then even when they're doing the exchanging of the guard, you know, the service, you know, when they swap mm-hmm. guards, like, there'll be people talking and giggling and laughing and carrying on, and they'll be like,
yeah, more respect.
We request you remain silent.
Yep.
An atmosphere of silence. Maintain an atmosphere of silence during the
change of the guard.
Yes, the change of the guard.
Yeah, the English have that with the
royal tie. The royal guards.
The royal
stuff,
guards.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Those are bear hats, bearskin hats.
Wow. But I mean, that's, and I know in Italy they have that big fountain there, and they keep torches lit.
Good.
24/7 all the time to commemorate. But I think that's their fallen soldiers in general. I don't think it's specific to the unknown soldier.
I don't think so, huh?
So, yeah. So, thank you guys. I was reading the chat earlier. Oh, yeah, you can't see this because the screen's blank. Yeah, that's because I forgot to switch it. That's my fault. I'm still getting the hang of this because I haven't done it in so long, where we streamed to Facebook and YouTube at the same time. So I'm just now seeing that the service we use puts all the chat in the
one.
YouTube chat. So if someone comments on Facebook, I'm seeing it in YouTube. So that's awesome.
My goodness.
So Annette mm-hmm. says they're taking a break in Abilene, and she'll see us tomorrow, I think, right? So,
Annette,
yeah.
Right on.
She'll be here tomorrow. All the way
cool.
up, all the way up from around Seattle, isn't it?
Right on. She's a sweetheart. Really helped me out in a dark time in my life.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
This could
she's
be cool.
Good
really,
person.
Really cool.
Gigi, JP, all you guys, and Karen. She mentioned her grandpa was in World War II as well
good.
Earlier. So, very cool. We want to thank you guys for spending. Spending
time
your
us.
Time with us, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's very cool.
Joe and
we enjoy doing this.
Lisa.
Hanging out
Lisa Scavarla.
Uh-huh.
Lisa was Janine's double on
oh,
the show.
Oh, I remember you saying that.
Yeah. They were in France here this last couple weeks. And Joe had sent me, we got talking back and forth. Anyways, sent me a lot of remembrance towns there. They still commemorate what the servicemen have done, especially with the 101st Airborne.
Oh, yeah?
Did for the town there. There's a monument set up for them. I have these pictures. I'll get them set up here for the next time we go on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, we got to show a lot of pictures, apparently.
There's a lot, yeah, we have to do.
Oh, I forgot.
So, the views of this DJ are not necessarily those of the owner of this station.
I recognize that voice.
Oh, yeah? You recognize?
Programming is anti-family. The Nietzsche. The throw.
Oh my
and
goodness.
Crystallizes animals.
You recognize that guy?
Oh, yeah, that came through there.
Right?
That's, go ahead.
Yeah, we'll be back on within a week. I don't know what day. Need to figure out what. I'll do a poll or something in the K-Bear South group and see what day is most convenient for
okay.
those of you guys that want to tune in. And we'll go by that, because otherwise we're going to jump on whenever we both kind of feel it, and
yeah.
it could be 3 a.m. on a Wednesday or something, so there ain't no telling.
Doing
and
this too, this is the second time we've done this, Corey. It gave me inspiration to I'll sit down and do some writing and be more prepared.
Oh, yeah, you're fine. You're fine, bro. You're articulate. But,
thank
I mean,
you.
Do whatever you want to do. I'm not going to tell you not to do anything.
It'll be apropos.
You know.
Heartfelt.
We need to start watching episodes is what we need to do.
Okay.
You know, we need to start, because you haven't, there's a lot of them you haven't seen. You haven't even seen yourself in these episodes.
That's true.
So, you know, I definitely want to incorporate that conversation into the mix, because I'm interested in hearing it as well. So if we could hook fans up with hearing your experience watching the show,
while
at,
I
and
still
at the same time I'm hearing it,
yeah.
you know.
While I can still remember it.
Hey, you know, it's like when the episodes we have watched, your memory starts getting sharp and you start spitting out memories like nothing. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I forgot about that. Oh, yeah, I forgot about this. It just comes out.
It does, doesn't it? It does. Yeah.
So
I'm looking forward to it. Thank you, everyone, for stopping by.
Thank you guys for stopping by. North to the future. And
love you all.
Don't love you all. And don't forget to dance with abandon.
What do we do now?
Well, Ed.
Peace.
Yes. All right. Peace.
Cause your friends don't dance, and if they don't dance, well, that's no friends of mine. Say, we can go where we want to, a place where they will never find. And we can act like we come from out of this world, leave the real one far behind. And we can dance.
Don't they?
You know what I'd like to do? Dance.
Until the war is over, and we're both a little older, unknown soldiers. soldiers.